Hello students, next we will look into the next topic of module 2, which is external sensors. Up till now we had studied internal sensors, which were basically looking into the internal sensing of the robot. That means how much angle joint has made, where is the tip of the workspace, or what is the velocity with which it is moving, what is the acceleration with which it is moving, all those things. So those were related to what is inside the robot or inside the robot structure. External sensors are mainly used so that the robot is able to understand its environment, especially the object on which it is what it is wanting to work on, the object of interest and the environment around it. This is what is the reason for having external sensors. Okay, so the external sensors are basically limit switches. Limit switches, what is the meaning of limit switches? I will not be dealing too much with limit switches. That's why I will just explain it here slightly. Let me first expand this view so that some of you are able to see it even. Okay, so what is limit switches? Limit switches are switches that are used for stopping the robot at some time. For example, you want the robot to move only up to this much distance, there you place a limit switch, and once it touches that switch, the robot will stop. So it can be placed at many positions. Okay, and then there are external sensors that measure force, temperature. A very important external sensor is basically camera. But camera we are not going to discuss here, because camera or the vision system will be dealt with totally as a different topic at the end of this module. So right now I will deal only with contact and non-contact sensors within the external sensor. So as I had previously told, external sensors are of two types. One is the contact sensor and the other one is called as the non-contact sensors. Contact sensors are those sensors which require physical touching, which require the object to touch the sensor. Now camera or light, these all can just send light or can receive light from an object. There is no need to touch the object. Whereas if you want to measure the temperature, now we are having contactless temperature measurement. Previously and all, it used to be not there, so we used to place it in the non-contact category, contact sensor category. Take the case of measuring the weight. You cannot just look at an object and decide what is going to be the weight, or you cannot sense it by sending some waves and getting the reflection of it. It's not going to work that way. You have to touch the body. The body has to touch the sensor to understand what is the weight of that body. So those sensors which require the object to touch it are basically coming under the category of contact sensors. And some of them are, for understanding what is the shape of the object. Right now, camera can do that, but since the textbooks are from quite some, old textbooks, so these categories are still there in the contact sensors category, and you can write them in the contact sensor category. Weight is another one. Weight is basically for, again, it is coming under contact sensors. Slippage is when suppose a hand or a gripper, we know that in the end of the robot, there will be a gripper, and the gripper has to grip some object. So sometimes the object is gripped, and when the robot is trying to take it, the object will slip off. Why is it slipping off? Because enough pressure has not been applied. So whether the object is slipping or not, there has to be a sensor for checking that. That is basically called as sensing the object slippage. Okay, so these are you know, sensors which require contact with the object. And the good thing is that generally these sensors are inexpensive and they require very less processing time. Because if we are talking about the case of camera or in the case of some light wave reflecting and coming or some light wave going and touching, all these require data processing in good, huge processing power. Whereas contact sensors generally they don't require too much of processing. That's why they are preferred. Okay. Some of the simple is the electrical switch. Okay, electrical switch is basically the, you know, robot when it reaches up to a certain limit, if it touches a switch and the whole thing goes off, that is basically the simple contact sensor for the electrical switch, contact sensor in case of robotics, which is the electrical switch. It is also inexpensive. Now, based on the touch, it can just give you an on-off signal, or it can even give you, you know, some three-dimensional data of where the pressure is applied and all. Another is pneumatic switches. Pneumatic switches is switches which work on the principle of air. So instead of touching, you are sending a stream of air, you know, high pressure air. That is pneumatic switches, but they are expensive. Okay. Similarly, sensors can be placed. For example, there is an array of sensors. An array of sensors. For example, let us take the case of a screen of your touch screen. Okay. Now, touch screen is basically an array of sensors. It's an array of sensors where the touch pressure or the capacitive effect is sensed by the sensor, and that, you know, basically does the processing, and we get a two-dimensional picture of where the touch might have been or where the movement might have gone. So we can have two-dimensional or sometimes even three-dimensional data when we are having, you know, sensors array for the case of contact sensors. Okay. Now, this application that they are talking about, sensor is locating the exact position of the hole so that the robot can insert part into it. This is somewhat old application. Nowadays, it is done completely with the help of camera. Okay. Now, tactile sensors are placed on the gripper. Or what is the meaning of gripper? I have already told, it's the end effector of the robot, that part that grips the object, that is the gripper. So tactile sensors, what is the meaning of tactile sensors? Tactile sensors means sensors that sense the touch. Okay, so touch based sensors are basically called as tactile sensors, which can feel or which can sense the touch. Okay, so tactile sensors are basically placed in the gripper. They can either touch, they can sense the touch, or they can even measure the pressure, or they can even measure what is the slipping or the slippage, the sliding that is going to happen. All these basically try to mimic the human skin. Okay, all these basically try to mimic the human skin. Now let us talk something about the human skin. What is a human skin? Human skin is basically having a lot of nerve endings, and everywhere the amount of sensing of the touch is not the same. It is different for each and every part. The fingertips are having very high sensitivity on touch, whereas, as it is written here, the wrist area or many other parts of the body, they don't have that much of touch sensation, whereas the fingertips are having very high touch sensitivity. Okay. Similarly, the sensing is also there in the skin on the rate of change of deformation in the skin. That means if there is any vibration, so vibration is what? Vibration is when you are having constant touch in an intermediate fashion. So you know, vibrations will be there. The skin is able to sense the touch, okay, and it is able to understand that it's a vibration only if it is more than 20 hertz. If it is less than that, it is not able to understand. Okay, and the maximum vibration that it can understand is 250 hertz. Beyond that, it is not able to understand the vibration, the human skin. Okay, and similarly, different frequencies in between it can also be understood. So these are all basically the contact type of the examples of how the robot is trying to mimicking the human hand or the human touch system for this contact for contact based sensors. For example, if we want to look at the temperature of something, we generally touch with our hands. If we want to find out the, you know, the weight of some body, we generally pick it in our hands to understand what is the weight of the body. So like that, the contact sensors are also basically doing the same kind of thing. So most of the mimicking, why we say mimicking, because most of the things that are made for robotics are trying to mimic the human form. Okay, so contact sensors are mostly trying to mimic the human capability of touch. Okay, next is the non-contact sensors. These are again sensors which are used to measure, these are coming under the category of external sensors which are used to measure the environment around the robot. Okay, one of the biggest example for that is the proximity sensor. That means without touching, it has to understand that it has reached the border somewhere, somewhere the border of its workspace, or it has to, you know, understand which path it has to go. So line following robot is basically trying to see where the line is. Okay, so proximity sensors are sensors which try to send, which tries to sense the proximity. One of the best example is, you know, in your cars, if you would see, the car has a sensor for sensing if there is, for parking, if there is any vehicle behind it, isn't it? What is that? That's a proximity sensor. How is it working? It is working in the basis of ultrasonic or maybe some other technology, maybe even the case of light. I'm not talking the case of car, but maybe even in some cases, light is also used for proximity, for understanding what is the distance between the, you know, object and the boundary. So that is basically proximity sensor. Again, this, since it's done using ultrasonic, there is no required of any touch. Similarly, previously I had said that, you know, limit switches are there. Limit switches was basically for, again, understanding what is the boundary. So instead of limit switches, we can have proximity sensors. Now, the proximity sensors can be ultrasonic. It can be even magnetic. That means, you know, when it reaches the border, there is some magnet there, which will, because of which it will understand that, okay, there is some magnetic effect because of which it has reached the end of its workspace. Or even optical is there. Instead of ultrasonic light, it might be optical, you know, waves that are being sent. If it's magnetic mode, it can sense a distance basically with the within a range of 3 by 8 to 5 by 8 inches. Okay, magnetic mode, how do they work? They basically work on the principle of, you know, reed relays or eddy current sensors. What is eddy current sensors? Eddy current sensors is if you are bringing a magnet close to the surface of a metal or a conductor, you know, eddy currents will be formed around it. So basically we can sense if eddy currents are there for finding out the presence or the proximity. Okay, another is the Hall effect device. Another non-contact type sensors is the optical sensors, which basically, you know, tries to measure through on and off method if there is any object in between it. Okay, now the optical system generally does not use visible light, it mostly uses infrared light. Okay, so these are all examples of non-contact sensors, and based on your syllabus, I will have to again see how much depth they go for each of these sensors. And if there is a little bit more depth they are asking in the question papers, what I will do is I will take another section on, you know, what is this optical sensors, we are having the ultrasonic sensors are having, we are having. So until that is discussed or that is understood, I will leave it here. We will go to the next topic. Thank you.